So this is a very quick chart about this. So right from 1642, Pascal invented the first mechanical calculating machine. And around after at most two centuries, there was Babbage and Ada Lovelace, the Babbage machine. Ada was the first programming, formal programming model. So they gave the design for a programmable machine. In 1943, there was a foundation of neural network established by Warren and Pitts, drawing parallels between the brain and computing machine. And 1950 is the real breakthrough, where Alan Turing came out with what he called as a Turing test, right? So he kept one machine and a human, and somebody will be asking questions. Both the machine and the human will be answering. And at the end, the person who is asking the question will not know whether the machine is answering or the human is answering. And ultimately, you should go and identify who is the machine and who is the human being, right? So they'll be sitting in a room asking questions, and answers will come from two quarters. One will be a machine, one will be a human. The person who is asking the question will not know who is that. At the end, this human being should tell which is the machine and which is the human being. So that's called Turing test. And this was introduced in 1950. 1955, artificial intelligence is coined during a conference devoted to this topic, right? And so the notion of machines intelligence to artificial intelligence. So 55 is where this name started. Around 65, ELISA, a natural language program, is created, which is basically, it can handle dialogues. Like today, your chat bot, right? You can chat today. If you look at many of the, for example, talking of Kumbakonam, City Union Bank has a beautiful chat bot, right? You can chat with the chat bot on the web screen, right? So it'll answer as if your clerk or your manager is as intelligent as a manager. It is as informed as a manager. So it can basically give you information about that. You can start using it in the CUB platform, CUB website, for example, right? So around, so ELISA was something at 1965. 1980s, where Edward actually created expert systems which emulate decision of human experts. For example, medical expert system. So it's all rule-based things. Okay, if the blood pressure is like this, this is like this, this is like this. If there's a cough, if there's an X-ray like that, then the expert system will say, oh, he has this he or she has this particular disease, and this is the treatment, etc. After that, the major breakthrough came in 1997, where the Deep Blue actually beat the world's chess champion Garry Kasparov, which was something big those days. In 2002, iRobo launched Roomba, an autonomous vacuum cleaner that avoids obstacles. So this was a beautiful moment. Then 2009, Google builds the first self-driving car to handle urban conditions. 2011, again, IBM's Watson defeats champions of US game, game show Jeopardy. Jeopardy is like Kaun Banega Crore, but they'll ask a lot of questions and this they have to answer. And US, the Watson actually bet that. And 2011 to 2014, all this Siri, Google Now, Cortana, they all use speech recognition to answer questions and perform simple tasks. That is where even if you buy some of the Maruti cars today, and many of these cars, there's a hands-free. So you can say, call somebody, right? And then it'll call you. It'll ask you, is their number. That's a good, beautiful conversation that can happen, right? And this, even today in many cars, almost in every car, you can connect your mobile phone through your Bluetooth to your infotainment system, which basically has this voice recognition, right? And around 2014, Goodfellow comes up with this generative adversarial networks. And so this is something very interesting, where, you know, you can start beating the AI system. You can start beating the human beings. So this is something which is very, very interesting. And around 2016, AlphaGo beats the professional Go player. Go is a game, and AlphaGo actually defeated Lee Sedol, who is one of the acclaimed Go players, 4-1. And then most universities have courses in artificial intelligence around 2018 and 2020. Every school now attempts to have, like your national school is now attempting to have courses in artificial intelligence. So this is the entire history, and this is how AI has come. And this is not yesterday's story, but it is around 3 to 4 centuries old, 3.5 or 3.33/4 century old story. That I would like to cover. I wanted to cover it in a single slide, and this is how it comes up. Okay. Now, this is all from a functionality point of view, right? We are talking about what one can do. It bet Kasparov, it bet Lee, it can answer questions. So these are all from a functional point of view. What is underneath? What is enabling these machines to do these functionalities? And that is what we are going to see on the top left of your screen, where there is something called artificial intelligence. A subset of that artificial intelligence is called machine learning, and a subset of that machine learning is called deep learning, right? So what is just artificial intelligence? The artificial intelligence is engineering of making, so it is basically rule based. It can be, it encompasses all these things. What is artificial intelligence that is not machine learning or deep learning? It's all these rule-based systems. For example, in a washing machine, right, 1990s, they gave this fuzzy washing machine. What is fuzzy about it? Depending on the weight, depending upon the weight, it'll pour that much amount of water. It'll pour that much amount of detergent, right? So if the weight is this much, do this. If the weight is this. So similarly, so this is basically what you call as rule-based systems. And there is an intelligence because the machine actually understands these rules and behave accordingly to the rules. But then came machine learning, where you have a lot of data and you understand from the data. So there is somebody who says that, okay, let us take even a blood test for corona detection. That's one attempt now being made. So if the blood test has some, there are some one blood test which can give you some, a couple of tests which can give you some 60 parameters. If these parameters are like this, and then there was corona, so we basically tell the machine with some examples, real-time examples, real-world examples. Okay, these are 10 people. This fellow had this blood test and these parameters, and this is the result, is corona positive. This parameter is corona negative. Like that, we give some 10, 15 examples. The machine basically learns all these things. And then you give a new blood test result to it. Then based on that examples, whatever it has gained the knowledge from those examples, it will now go and say, oh, yes, he has corona or not. This is actually called supervised learning. And this we can classify it as machine learning, right? But in the deep learning, it is that, you know, as and when the learning is happening, suppose it does something wrong and it is pointed out, it automatically relearns itself and it learns by its own mistakes and correcting. So if it had correctly predicted, then it goes in that way. If there's a wrong, it automatically corrects itself, and that is called deep learning. So if you start looking at this whole spectrum from one end to another end, we start off with what we call as artificial intelligence, which is just, we start off with rule-based systems. Then we have systems that are basically driven by, you know, data. You learn from data and then make a decision. And then systems that self-correct themselves. So this is how we come into the whole AI stuff. So AI systems, the bottom left, what you see in violet color is the types of AI. So one thing is there's something called reactive AI. This has no memory, but only response to different stimuli. There's a limited memory. It uses memory to learn and improve its responses. Then there is something called self-aware. It has human-like intelligence and self-awareness. And then there's theory of mind. It understands the needs of other intelligent entities and goes. So if you take this cycle from reactive, limited memory, self-aware, and theory of mind, these are all the different types of AI machines that we are looking at. So today, if you could say that we are almost in the limited memory segment. Now we have to do some self-aware type of machines, and then something which will basically come into the theory of mind. Theory of mind, there's again very less understanding about theory of mind. So when you look at this entire spectrum of AI, the challenge in front of us is to even get some very highly competitive limited memory machines, but then build in self-awareness and then start addressing the theory of mind. And that will be the next century's problem. And that is where we are leading to. Okay. So this is what we see. What has AI? So this is all about A and I of the AI, the artificial and intelligence of AI, and what AI has enabled over a period of time. The first wave that we see somewhere in 1998 was this internet AI, where you had this Skype, your Google, your Facebook, your Amazon, and all these things, which basically gave you lot. You want to search for something, they give you this, they give you many functionalities based on this. The second wave was, this was just basically an internet connectivity that it possesses. But then this basically translated into the wave two, which is basically on the business aspects. Like example, there were a lot of things AI became a part of the business decisions that we can take, like prediction became very important at that point of time. The wave three that we got again now became a perception based AI, right? So where, you know, there are a lot of things that today go by perception, and so there are a lot more of processing that happens on the data that is collected over the internet, where you start making more intelligent decisions rather than business decisions. So the 2015 and above, we are seeing a lot more of autonomous AI, where will autonomous system, like for example, the Uber app is an autonomous app by itself. So you just tell what you want, it takes care of bringing a car to your doorsteps. And from the driver point of view, the driver says, I need business. It takes care of giving him business, right? And everything else is autonomously controlled by the app. Okay, so the app is the main control office of the Uber, right? So if you look at 1998 to 2015, what has enabled all these things? How did wave two come from wave one? Because more data got accumulated. How did wave three come from wave two? Again, more data came up. And how does wave four come from wave three? More data got generated. So as you get more and more data, then you start seeing more and more waves there. So the enabler for all these things was data. So what has been enabling people today is data. So instead of actually teaching AI per se, one of the important things that we should teach at the school level, like we had this, in my opinion, one very foolish decision of removing biology and putting computer science in plus one and plus two. One of the most foolish decision as a computer science professor I could tell today, right? Because computers at that level need not need a teacher to be taught. What you teach in plus two or plus one, a kid can learn by itself very, very early in his life. The thing is that biology is lost. Today, who is going to solve the corona problem? For example, let us take the worldwide most important problem. We need understanding of biology, right? So the basic anatomy of man is completely thrown off. And now we say that we want to make a machine which will mimic a man. So AI's requirement is abolish computer science in plus one and plus two and put biology. So that will be the first requirement for AI. So that is my very strong recommendation, right? Your national school can try and abolish computer science and teach biology, because that is more important, as I have been talking of. And what should be taught at this level is, how do we go and appreciate data, right? You get a lot of data. How do you make sense out of this data? So data science or data analytics is much more important to talk of, rather than talking about AI and machines and chess and Go and all these stories. Okay, so that is something which is very important. And this biology is a very serious comment. I think the school, if you are really dedicated to bring AI, if you want your alumnus to shine in AI, then certainly abolish computer science and put only biology in plus two. So this is my recommendation. Right. So let us now see the trends of AI. So people always say that, you know, technology actually goes by winters. Like there'll be a boom, again nothing, then boom, again nothing, and then boom, and again nothing. So lot of people say that there have been winters. For example, 1960s there was a boom, then there was a winter, nothing happened. Then again 1980s 90s there was a boom, again there was a complete thing. Then 2010 now there is a boom now, hopefully a boom now. And then they say that there will be again winter, and then there will be a fourth wave. So what the world predicts today is that the first wave, that was good at reasoning, but the second wave is good at learning. The third wave actually became excellent at learning, but then there will be again a winter, and then there will be human level intelligence, which will be the fourth wave. And the real people who will shine in that fourth wave are people who have understood all the sciences very well: mathematics, physics, chemistry, and biology. So today, I want the parents also to understand that if your kid wants to become an AI expert, they should do the school physics, science, physics, biology, and chemistry and mathematics very well, right? So if you have a choice between, don't put them onto a Python course today. Don't. Let them learn the basic sciences very strongly, and that is very, very important to reach this fourth wave, which you see in 2040. That will be somewhere, you know, another 20 years from now. The mid career for a plus two kid today would be somewhere in 2040. And if you want to prepare them for this today, you should make them very good, very attached to science. They have to learn physics with passion. They have to learn chemistry with passion. They have to learn biology with passion. They have to learn mathematics with passion, not just to clear examination. And that is very important. If you want your kid to play a very crucial role in the fourth wave of AI. So there are two different opinions here. People say that there will be a winter after this current wave, and then there will be a fourth wave. But then there are a lot of people who say that there will be no winter. There will be a current boom, and that boom will peak somewhere in 2050, 2060, and we need to prepare, every country needs to prepare themselves to meet that challenge at that point of time.